Well, welcome to the talk on fentanyl basics. My name's Brian Wimbigler. I'm a pharmacist by training. And I do a lot of work with the Tennessee Department of Mental Health and Substance Abuse Services on drug-related topics. So today we're going to talk about fentanyl and just the basics to give you some really factual information so that you know what the real facts are and you can sift through a lot of the misinformation. So that's really one of the main reasons we're doing this presentation. In Tennessee, 3 out of 4 overdose deaths involved fentanyl. So it's in all of our communities. It's mixed into a lot of other drugs. So it's something that you need to be aware of. Another reason this talk is really important is that 92% of articles about fentanyl contain some degree of misinformation, including 37 published by national news agencies. So this is ABC, NBC, CBS. So a lot of those really big, broad, they reach everyone. So it's really important that the facts get out there to you guys. The reason that's important is it causes a lot of fentanyl panic. I'm sure you've heard about the possibility of reaching down and picking up a dollar bill that has fentanyl on it and overdosing. Now, that's not necessarily true. So a lot of that is misinformation. So I'm going to talk to you about the facts today and really lay out why that's not true so that it avoids some of this fentanyl panic, which delays or provides less effective responses to overdose. It causes a lot of unnecessary stress, which can translate into panic attacks. And it furthers counterproductive policies, punitive responses and consequences, and unnecessary resource expenditures, like spending money on things that we don't need for protection, because in a lot of instances, this drug isn't going to get through your skin. So let's just break it down. What are opioids? Well, opioids are a type of chemical that bind to the opioid or mu receptor in the brain. Fentanyl is one of these. There's also some really common ones that are used in everyday medicine. Morphine, codeine, hydrocodone, oxycodone. Also street drugs like heroin. So a lot of fentanyl is mixed in with heroin. The thing that's different about fentanyl is it is a completely man-made substance. It's all laboratory made. So unlike morphine that you can derive from the poppy plant, this is all synthetic. Types of fentanyl, primarily what we're talking about in terms of overdose are those illicit or illegal substances. We don't see a lot of overdoses from those that are dispensed from a pharmacy and that were written from a physician, like for fentanyl patches to help control pain. But the rise in fentanyl involved overdose deaths is primarily, I want to drive this home, the illegal or illicit type products, not the fentanyl patches that someone on hospice care or with chronic cancer pain might be using. So when we look at those medicinal types, the most common form is a patch. It's a transdermal patch, so it affixes to the skin, and it has special chemicals in a gel matrix that break down the skin layer and allow that medication to leach through the skin and get into the bloodstream. So it's a special formulation. That happens over a period of 48 to 72 hours. So even if you stick a patch on, you won't even feel the effects for a day or two. So it takes a long time for that pharmaceutical product to absorb through your skin. There are other types, and it's just all a method to get that into someone's system. So think about someone who might have laryngeal or throat cancer and can't swallow. They might use a patch or a lozenge or a nasal spray or something like that to deliver that pain relief. Again, fentanyl is very strong. It's lab made. It's 50 times stronger than heroin and 100 times stronger than morphine. So that kind of puts it in relative perspective. You can see over there on the slide some pictures of what would be theoretically a lethal dose to someone who's opioid naive. And when you look at those at the very bottom, some of the ones that have been found in our state, some of these analogs, we've got acetyl fentanyl, furanyl fentanyl, and carfentanil. Carfentanil is a product that our large animal hospitals and zoos use to put elephants to sleep for veterinary procedures. So when you look at the volume of distribution or size of an elephant relative to you or I, that shows you a visual depiction of the relative potency and strength of carfentanil versus even heroin or fentanyl. I've thrown out the word analog several times. So analogs are part of this process because remember, this is synthetic and man-made, and this isn't really happening in FDA-controlled and regulated laboratories. So there's other things that are made in this process, and typically those are more potent than what they're really trying to make. So you can see down there, there's the fentanyl molecule and acetyl fentanyl. It's just switching a single molecule on there that can either make it less potent or more potent, but when it comes to these fentanyl analogs, they're typically slightly more potent than the fentanyl itself. Illicit fentanyl has been found across the board, not just in opioid products, but in all products in some degree. So when you look here, it can be found in heroin, it can be added to cocaine and marketed as a better cocaine, it can be found in methamphetamine, benzodiazepines, and you see over there on the right, the top picture is pharmaceutical grade oxycodone. The bottom picture is one that has been pressed to look like that product. So outside of the pharmaceutical manufacturing process, it's impossible to equally and evenly distribute fentanyl in any product. So it's kind of like the chocolate chip cookie effect. If you got that pressed fake tablet, you know, you might get a tablet with some fentanyl, you might get a tablet with no fentanyl. Just like when you bite into a chocolate chip cookie, you might get a bite with a chocolate chip, you might not. So that's what we're dealing with these adulterated products. It can be found primarily in a powder form, and then that can be pressed into pills. It can be dropped on blotter paper or small candies and taken that way, so that would be dissolved in water. It can be in eyedroppers or nasal sprays, and we've talked a lot about this one. Pills that look like real pharmaceutical grade products, but it's really just fentanyl pressed to look like something that you might be familiar with and think is safe because it came from a pharmacy. When it comes to vaping, the only vaporization products that are FDA regulated are the tobacco products. So those things that you can buy in the one aisle in major department stores and grocery stores, that tobacco checkout. Outside of that, in vape shops and those type places, these aren't regulated, so there's no way to really tell what is in those vape products. So could there be fentanyl in there? Absolutely. Could there be marijuana in there? Absolutely. It could be anything in these vapes that are unregulated. But to date, there have been very few documented and confirmed laboratory tests to show that fentanyl has been in the vape juice or cartridges themselves. What has been found is powder and other things on those devices, but to date, we don't have any laboratory confirmed cases that fentanyl's making it into the vaporization products. So what is your exposure risk? The main thing to keep in mind here is fentanyl has to get into your bloodstream and travel to your brain to have any kind of effect. So that's really important. So the ways that that can happen are obviously the most common one, just taking a pill or ingesting that, chewing, eating, any kind of swallowing. Touching your eyes, nose, or mouth, because our skin is our first line of defense to a lot of things, viruses, bacteria, drugs, water, you name it. So if we get it on our hands and then we introduce it into our mouth, nose, or eyes, that is a way that this potent product can get into our bloodstreams. So if you know there was fentanyl around the scene, it's very important to wash your hands with soap and water to physically remove that product. And then there's inhalation or breathing, and we'll talk about all three of these methods. So for skin exposure, remember, fentanyl patches are the only pharmaceutical grade fentanyl product that is designed and made to pass through your skin. Everything else just can't do it, and I'll show you a slide coming up to really drive that home point in terms of fentanyl's molecular size. So even if you were exposed to a fentanyl patch, it would take 3 to 13 hours to deliver any amount of drug to produce any pharmacological effect, and then about 35 hours for full effect. So the main risk with fentanyl patches are those that have been discarded into the trash where a pet or child might then ingest that product. So that's the primary risk there. Now I promise I'd show you why it can't get through your skin. So if you look at this, fentanyl in its smallest form, in the powder form, is about 10 micrometers. And if you look below that, there are a lot of other things that are much smaller that don't get through our skin. One of them is red blood cells. So if fentanyl at 10 micrometers could get through our skin, we'd be in trouble if blood at 7 to 8 could get through our skin, because we'd be bleeding out everywhere. So that just shows you. And then if you go down, there's coronavirus, the flu, bacteria, all things that we know don't get through our skin. So if those smaller things can't, we can't expect something with a much larger particle size to just easily pass through our skin. So that's just a really important visual distinction on why this doesn't typically happen. And you see here, there's things like pollen, sand, dust particles. All of these things are about the same size as powdered fentanyl, and none of these things get through our skin. Now, pollen's a great example of something that gets in our eyes, right? Especially here in East Tennessee, that can cause allergy symptoms and allow allergens into our circulatory system. So unless that fentanyl product gets in your ears, your nose, your mouth, any opening that bypasses your skin, that's a way in. But healthy, intact skin in and of itself isn't a way that fentanyl can get through. Now, if you've got paper cuts, open wounds, it can absolutely get in there. So you can use gloves for an extra layer of protection, but casual exposure to fentanyl, simply touching it, isn't going to cause an overdose. So don't panic. The powder crystalline form cannot pass through your skin. This includes fentanyl analogs. Even if it's dissolved in water, that doesn't change the particle size. Does it make it easier for that to get around and travel around? Yes, but it doesn't change the particle size and doesn't change its ability to get through your skin. Wounds or cuts, they have to be open. And if you can see blood, that is a pathway into your bloodstream. So any kind of wound that hasn't healed, cut, that is a way that the fentanyl can get in. So be very, very cautious if you do have open wounds on your hand, and absolutely wear gloves in those scenarios. It's not gonna aerosolize. So we hear a lot of things about methamphetamine, and we see people in full hazmat suits. That's because a lot of the chemicals used to make meth vaporize and are in the air and are very volatile, meaning they can explode and they're flammable. So it's very dangerous, and those are easily breathed in and cause damage. Fentanyl, it doesn't aerosolize and it doesn't vaporize. So that powder is going to stay where it is unless it's forced into the air. So if you're in a scenario where there's fentanyl, don't do anything that's going to aerosolize that product. If it's in a bag, don't push the air out so that you can seal it. That's going to aerosolize that product. Don't turn on fans. Don't turn on HVAC units. So it's going to stay where it is. How do you respond to an overdose? You're going to be close to the person. You're going to be touching them. Casual or incidental exposure is minimal risk. Unless you transfer that product that was on your hands or in that scene, it has to get in your bloodstream and travel to your brain. So that's the main thing. Because of misinformation, many people think that simply being in a room with fentanyl or just touching it is going to cause an overdose, and that just doesn't happen. So I'm trying to relieve you of that fear. Now, is it ultra potent, and does it take just a very small amount to overdose on? Absolutely. So it's not a benign substance, but you don't have to worry about overdosing and not responding to someone because you're afraid that incidental or accidental casual exposure is going to cause an overdose. When someone's experiencing an overdose, everything slows down. Their respiratory rate, their speech, all of those things, and then they stop breathing. So those are signs and symptoms of an overdose. Things that aren't signs of an overdose is anything that's excitatory. So rapid breathing, talking. So if someone's saying, I'm overdosing, they're not. That's your sign they're not overdosing. Now, could they subsequently overdose? Possibly, if they had some on them, on their hands, and it got into their blood system later. But if they're breathing fine and they're just panicking because they've gotten a lot of this misinformation that, oh my gosh, I just touched fentanyl, I'm going to overdose, that can lead to a panic attack type scenario. So some key distinctions. Over on the left side there, unconscious, unresponsive, shallow, slow respirations, turning blue, anything that's related to slowed or labored breathing, that can be related to an opioid overdose. Alert, hyper, rapid breathing, rapid heart rate, numbness in fingers, chest pain, that is more stimulant related and might not necessarily be related to an opioid overdose. In that scenario, naloxone or an opioid antagonist may not help, but in the other one with slowed breathing, it can absolutely help that person. So when you're responding, if you've got gloves, wear them, but don't let not having gloves prevent you from assisting someone in need. Wash your hands, even if you wore gloves. Remove the gloves and wash your hands. Alcohol hand sanitizers don't work because this isn't a living thing like a virus or bacteria, so there's nothing to kill. You have to physically remove that product from your hands, and the only way to really reliably do that is with soap and water. And then get checked out and follow up with the medical provider. If you think you've had an exposure, it's not a bad idea to go to the hospital just in case so that they can follow up with you, because you may have had an exposure and didn't know it. Don't do anything that's going to cause it to go airborne. Don't touch your eyes, nose, mouth, anything like that without having washed your hands thoroughly before. And definitely don't eat or drink anything after a known exposure, whether you help someone or were in a room that fentanyl might have been present. Basic precautions are enough to protect you from an overdose due to casual exposure. So just the basics, hand washing, wearing gloves, those type things. So don't let an irrational fear from misinformation cause a delay in treating someone that might really need your life-saving help, whether that's CPR, administering an opioid antagonist, or anything like that.